Hello, and thank you for joining us today for the Economic Development Council of Okaloosa County's monthly business forum, The Vision of Growth. My name is Debbie Bodenstein, and I am the Economic Development Council's Vice President of Business Development and Public Relations. Joining me today, we have my colleague, Caroline McCoy, our Director of Administration and Special Projects. Our guest today is Mr. Brad Swanson. He is Vice President of Corporate and Strategic Partnerships for the Florida Chamber of Commerce. He has been with the Florida Chamber of Commerce for 6 years and been a business advocate for over 11 years. He's here today to share with us some topics and issues that came up in our most recent 2012 Florida State Legislative Session. Thank you, Brad, for being here with us.
Well, thank you, Debbie. It's an honor to be here with you both. Thank you for the invitation. You know, as the voice of Florida's business community, the Florida Chamber saw some good in this year's legislative session. We had a ton of distractions, and I'll get into those in just a minute. But you know, as we advocate for 139,000 businesses across the state of Florida, and we bring that voice to the legislative process, it's important to remember that the business community, while we focus every day and we work all day, you know, 6 a.m. till midnight, the business community faces competition in the legislative process. And when we're there, we're up against 1,300 lobbyists in the process, all representing a vast amount of other special interests. So as much as everyone in business wants more out of their legislature and more out of the legislative process, there's a lot of other factors that go into competing with our voice in the legislature. So I look forward to sharing those ideas and those thoughts with you.
Very good, very good. And what exactly is your role within the Florida Chamber?
Yeah, well, the Florida Chamber, let me step back. The Florida Chamber of Commerce for the past 100-odd years has worked to carry both the needs and the vision of what the future of Florida will be and what infrastructure will need to be in place to support that growing economy. So for the past 10 years, the Florida Chamber of Commerce has led the way to create statewide vision for what the business community will need. We know that Florida, this year, will become the third largest state in the union. And by 2030, we're expecting approximately 6 million more people in the state of Florida. So with 6 million more people, as we know, we're going to need more electrical infrastructure, more water supply, more of what Florida has and already makes us great. But we're going to just need more underpinnings to support that new and improved economy. Additionally, for that future of Florida, we're going to need to say, okay, who are we competing with? Do we compete with contiguous states, or is Florida a global leader, and are we competing with the largest nations around the world? You know, we would rank in the top 20 as an economy if we were solely by ourselves competing against the rest of the world. So with that in mind, for Florida to not only work in that new economy but be competitive, it's important to both strike a balance between what we need and what we're reacting to in the current economic crisis or challenges, and also set the vision and then set legislation in place that will prepare Florida to compete in that future economy. So that's what the Florida Chamber does, both as far as creating vision through our foundation, both advocating for today's needed legislation, and then also we turn our focus in a campaign year to the campaign and politics that are required to elect pro-business candidates. So the Florida Chamber works to galvanize that business community to carry that vision forth on all three of those fronts so that the future of Florida is led by business versus some of those antagonists of a capitalism-based economy that we have and we enjoy in America.
Very good. Yes, thank you.
Okay. We know that the Florida Chamber is very involved with the legislature. When we've heard how the reapportionment has affected the legislature in both content and timing, where does that process stand, and how does it affect the business community?
Sure. Well, if you look at the process, the Florida Chamber, we bring 35 lobbyists to the Hill every year during the legislative process, and we typically have between 25 or 35 issues that we are proffering to the legislature and working with them. And the good thing right now is the legislature is overwhelmingly pro-business. So it's a good time to be living in Florida with the legislature that we have representing us overall. But if you look at reapportionment, it's something we do every 10 years. It changes the schedule, number one. It moves it from a March, April, first week in May, up to a January, February, you know, first week in March scenario. So it pushes the schedule up, which then crunches your weeks, your time, your preparation, your ability to do it. Then the content itself of reapportionment sucks the oxygen out of the room, if you will, of the legislative process, because if we think about it, you know, our representative democracy is focused on electing and voting for those people we send. So when you don't know where your lines are as an elected official, your focus is on hey, you know, what will be the fair districts for our citizens? And also, if I am currently elected, what will that process mean both for our economy and our legislature and our policy, but obviously politics are involved. So from a political standpoint, what are the challenges there? So this year we saw great leadership by Senator Gates and Speaker Designate Will Weatherford in that process. They finished their first round, released it, sent it to the court, and the court accepted the House districts, sent the Senate districts back, and the Senate was called back in for a special session, which they just concluded yesterday. So the Senate redid their maps, and in accordance, we have a couple of new constitutional amendments on the books that kind of drive that process and refine it a bit more. So the Senate now has finalized that new Senate map. Both maps have to be approved by both the House and the Senate, have been approved, and now they're being sent back to the courts. So the courts will review that. If they approve of the new lines, they'll move forward with it. If they don't, it's then the responsibility to draw the districts for the Senate side will then be drawn by the court. We'll watch that process closely. The Florida Chamber has the Florida Chamber Political Institute, which is a nonpartisan group that evaluates both candidates, but also watches processes like that very closely, because it, literally, if you change a Senate district line by a block or two blocks, it can change the entire makeup of a district and push it. If it's a 51-40 for one party or another, it can flip it just the other side. So then, you know, both parties are saying, okay, you know, should we be running? Legislators will be looking, am I now living in a new district? Will I be running? And what we've seen on this round, one of the big drivers and an impact for business, is we've seen a number of great pro-business candidates now in the role of saying, well, are we going to run against each other? Am I going to step down as a fellow pro-business candidate and let my colleague go ahead and carry that district? We've seen it up here in the case of Marty Coley and Brad Drake, two great representatives, and we're looking at that process overall across the state of Florida. So we're seeing an impact of business, which is why the business community is now, once the legislature finishes, we're laser focused on elections now. Well, getting the legislation across the finish line, but we're focused on elections. So reapportionment definitely was a huge distraction from a normally crowded time, because in an election year, there's also a lot of other policy. It's different in a non-election year versus an election year as to what type of policy is put forward. So we had election year politics, we had reapportionment, and we had an enormous distraction when out of state and out of country casino interests tried to make a run at Florida and bring Las Vegas style casino gambling to Florida. So those three humongous distractions would have derailed most other states' legislatures, but this legislature ignored those distractions. They stayed on track, and they actually passed more legislation than what is normal in an election year despite those distractions. So we're grateful that they pushed 25 chamber-backed bills for the business community, and it was tough, but overall, I'd say it was a solid legislative session.
Now, with the reapportionment, if it does go to the courts, mm-hmm. what is their deadline?
Gosh, you'd have to ask me that. I believe their deadline is first week in June for qualifying. So they need to have those wrapped up by then. So essentially, they've got, I think 30 or 45 days to finalize it. I don't know what the exact mm-hmm. dates are, but I can definitely provide that to the EDC, okay. and anyone that wants to call afterwards, we can get that
thanks,
to them.
Thanks. Sure. Well, now we've talked about reapportionment being sort of the elephant in the room mm-hmm. during this last session, but you did mention that there was a lot of other legislative business that mm-hmm. was conducted during the session.
Yep.
Could you go into a little more depth about some of those business, those ones that would affect our businesses?
Sure, sure. Well, we had some really interesting successes and great successes this year. You know, I think the first one that I would call out would be the work that was done on unemployment comp. You know, now again, Senator Gates and Speaker Designate Will Weatherford worked to just handle a major issue that would have been an increased burden on business. As it stands right, as it stood before the legislative session from the 2011 to the 2012 year cycle in the tax structure, what would have happened is you would have had the base rate for an unemployment comp tax standard go from $7,000 to $8,500. Mm-hmm. That it roughly equates to approximately $70 to $170 of what you'd have to pay per employee. And what that totals out to for the Florida economy would have been $117 million worth of new fees and costs to Florida business. Huge, enormous, almost $1 billion. So if we look at the great strides that the legislature took through great leadership, they stepped forward and they reduced that new burden by $550 million over the next 2 years. So it's an enormous reduction in what business was going to face. So just on unemployment comp reform alone, there was just a great stride and a great lift by the folks that led on those issues. So the Florida Chamber is just grateful to Senator Gates and Speaker Weatherford, or Speaker Designate Will Weatherford. So if we look at that first success, that was great. But if we want to look at some of the underpinnings of business, we always think about regulation, taxes, things of that nature, that sort of it's the death by a thousand cuts for business owners. But if we look at this legislative session, what we saw was no new taxes, no new regulation, no new fees come out of this legislative session. So in a time where other states are saying we only increase fees or taxes by X amount, the Florida legislature held the line on new taxes and new fees and new regulation, which was an immense win in and of itself had we not done some of the other great victories that we had seen. So that was great. Now, if you compound that win with the fact that we were also facing a $2 billion budget shortfall, so there's another oxygen stealer from the environment to pass good policy. You look at those distractions. On top of all that, they were still able to push that forward and get that win. If you look at some of the other wins that we could have had, or that we had, spaceport facilities. Now here's a fantastic piece of legislation that allows Florida to take our existing infrastructure in the space world and convert it and make it available for incentives so that we can capitalize on the commercial space transport industry that we see building in Florida. Florida's led the world in space. Now, consequently, space vendors are also military vendors. We've got amazing bases in Florida, so we've got vendors that supply both to NASA and supply to all the bases, of which up here you have Tyndall, Eglin, which one am I missing? The Naval NAS, Naval Air Station. So these bases also have clusters of military contractors and suppliers all around them, and that engineering, that science base, really where we pump our STEM degrees, our science, technology, engineering, and mathematical degrees into in Florida, the nice thing is we can keep those folks here both through our existing military infrastructure and then through these new incentives to keep space tourism and space endeavors launching out of Florida. So the spaceport facilities bill was a great win for Florida. Secondly, we also had the NNC law, which we face, which is the numeric nutrient criteria. The federal government had attempted to place a unique standard on Florida that said that we would have had to have had our water standards, essentially our drainage water, up to the quality of what we see out of our taps. So what our state did was we came together and said, well, we think this is onerous and it's unique to Florida. So if you're gonna do it, either every state has to do it or Florida shouldn't face this. So we saw the legislature step up and pass a law and an effort that would combat the Florida unique NNC standards, which will help both farmers, cities that are providing water, because ultimately if we did enact that, it would be a massive amount of new water infrastructure that all cities and counties would have to pay for and then subsequently pass on as a tax to local businesses and residents mm-hmm. and owners. So some huge wins there. Also on water quality, we saw a few other bills that were there that will both hit agriculture-based business businesses and some of our technology manufacturers in Florida. So we saw some neat areas in the world of land use, which we used to call growth management, which now I think we're seeing growth leadership in the state of Florida in the worlds of land use. So some neat legislation that came out of that side of it. I would say that workers' comp was one that it falls under the still have work to do. That's a $62 million saving for businesses, but here you have a scenario in Florida where a certain group of pharmacy providers, which would be doctor's offices, have a different schedule of how they provide medications across the state of Florida, whereas pharmacies and hospitals are regulated under a pharmacy standard. So it's again, $62 million in the scope of the Florida economy may not seem like a lot, but if you're paying for a workers' comp claim and you pay five times as much for a medication and you're a small business for somebody who's out, it's a big deal. Mm-hmm. So again, that's work left on the table to do. Florida still sits the 42nd worst legal climate in our nation. So, you know, we've got a lot of work to do in that world. And I'll say this, the union-backed agendas and the trial bar did not sit on the sidelines this year. They're there. So the great thing was is we saw the business community, including chambers in this area from Destin, Fort Walton to Pensacola, all step up and really impact the legislative process, both with phone calls, in-person visits. It was encouraging to see how active the business community is becoming within the legislative process, and really almost stealing a page out of the Organize Now playbook, and really taking it to the legislature, which is great because they need that kind of support when the other side has messaging going out like crazy.
So for the bills that pass, what's the process from here?
Well, I would say the number one process that we're looking at is right now that they've passed, so they're all sitting on the governor's desk, for lack of a better description. The great thing is we have a pro-jobs, pro-business governor who we think will just continue, we hope, obviously, but we believe that he'll continue to hit home runs out of the park and sign this legislation. We know they're in the process of looking for locations for bill signings, so that's always positive. Mm-hmm. Those are positive messages that we see coming out of the governor's office. And although you never can tell, because that's how the process is, we believe that all of the chamber-backed legislation will be signed and put into play. And we think that is just a great success for Florida business, not only for the businesses that are here, but for those we want to bring here, so that when we have the Super Bowls or we have the RNCs or anything that brings business to Florida to see, you can say, oh, by the way, we have the number one most friendly business climate in the country, and we want to really drive the overall multi-year jobs agenda to have Florida be the number one jobs creator in the nation again. And, you know, we go back and forth between Texas, but we know Florida's number one.
Well, now that the official season is over, and we know the governor has until June 30, I believe it is, to sign off or make decisions on mm-hmm. those, what's next for the business community, and what's next for Florida Chamber of Commerce?
Sure. Well, as I mentioned before, the reapportionment piece really changed the political landscape, and it's put a lot more campaigns into play. As you know, everyone's up for re-election this year, so it's one of those unique years where you know typically you'll have offices and districts that'll alternate when they're running versus year. This year, everyone's up for election. So with the new lines, the jockeying for position, the Florida Chamber is laser focused on elections. We're across the state right now with our political institute over the next 2 months interviewing every single candidate that's running for office in Florida, analyzing every single district down to those blocks that I mentioned. And the reason we do this is, A, the Political Institute provides that information to its members so that the other associations who are members of that can gauge and say, okay, here's a candidate that's pro-business, good on our issues, this is somebody we want to get behind. And I think it's the galvanizing of the business community behind those candidates that are pro-business and supporting them and making sure that we can either, A, get them to return to the legislature for the next cycle so they can hold the line and continue to bring the ball down the field, but also bringing new pro-business leadership. We have a lot of folks that were term limited out. So looking for those new candidates that understand that Florida is driven by business, small business, you know, to the nth degree, and it's those folks that look out for the mom and pop shops across Florida as well as our large employers in Florida, and that say, okay, what legislation drives us to A, not only survive, but to B, be competitive in that future economy. That is the goal that we are looking for at the Florida Chamber. So we'll transition from interviewing to fundraising, and then of course during election time being fully engaged and paying attention to the minutia of every twist and turn of those key and targeted campaigns across the state. And that's the biggest part. You know, when you vote on election day, that's your first chance you vote. You pick up the phone, you can vote every time with a legislator on a piece of legislation as a business owner, every time you make a call. You can vote by getting in your car and driving to the legislator's office or over to Tallahassee for that time. And specifically, you can vote when you put your boots on the ground as a business owner and get out there and help those candidates that are pro-business. So what we'll do in between now and the next couple of weeks, we'll publish a How They Voted, which is a guide to how every elected official voted during the last legislative session. It's a great tool. It's available both on our website at floridachamber.com. It's also available through all of our chamber partners as well. They can have that so that they can evaluate, hey, is this candidate pro-business? They can always feel free to call the chamber or call their local chamber to get a read on it, and so the voting process happens continuously in our view, both in the elections process, the legislative process, and then of course we're encouraging the governor, although we believe this one won't need a lot of encouragement. We think every last phone call helps to make sure they know how important that legislation is.
Mm-hmm. Now the Florida Chamber also provides several other items, materials, mm-hmm. that are could be beneficial to our business owners to keep up with the issues, and can you share a little bit about those?
Absolutely. The Foundation is probably one of the best bases of information for both business owners that want to know what's going on in their county. You know, partnering with their local EDC, for example, is step number one. Step number two is signing up for the Florida Scorecard drops and breaks, and they do a monthly newsletter. For the issues of the day, the Florida Chamber has a full bandwidth of information. If you said, okay, my issues are growth leadership, my issues are taxation and regulation, mine are climate, quality of life, we certainly know here in the Panhandle that from the beach to the intercoastal, hotels and tourism are number one. So quality of life is key. That's regulation. That's your taxation. This comes back to your gambling issues of the world. What will hurt our economy or help it succeed despite the national economy? So you can sign up for any individual issue, or you can sign up for them all, so that you are tapped and tasked with good relevant information as to the legislature. Joining your local chamber is of course, you know, as equally as high of a great step to take forward in engaging with your local business community, because we know taxation comes from your local city, your county, and the state legislature. So being involved in those groups and paying attention and getting that informational receipts from your EDC, across the board, the Florida Chamber encourages, you know, full immersion, if you will, into the process. But we know business owners are busy. We know that 99% of their time is spent running their business, and a second away from their business is valuable. But the more that we can get the business community to engage in the process, Marianne Johnson, our political director, has a great slogan. She says, if you're not at the table, you're on the menu. And that's really how the business community, you know, is engaging in this process across our state. So it's encouraging, but as I said, there's a lot of work left to do. And I think that that going forward, once we step out of the foundation and we start engaging in legislative advocacy, your local chamber or the Florida Chamber is going to be happy to take, you know, anyone that wants to advocate on behalf of pro-business legislation. Because I think so often we see either reported or from a from the opposition, pro-business does not mean anti-employee. Mm-hmm. Pro-business is pro-employee. Mm-hmm. But I think that you know, folks that seek to exploit the process, their goal is to drive a wedge in between employees and employers. And the more that we can all work together and have a flat market, if you will, where we're all working towards the growth of Florida, we understand that from somebody who mows the lawn to somebody that cranks on a calculator in an office is just as valuable towards driving Florida's economy forward, and their participation in that process is vital. And so I think that's the Florida Chamber's goal, is to motivate everyone who has time, is willing, and is able to engage in the process. And right here you've got fantastic leadership in your legislators. Senator Gates would be one that I would say, you know, if he's recruiting an army right now from a policy standpoint, because we know we have to walk a fine line here on this show. I would say from a policy standpoint, please let him know how you're passionate about pro-business legislation. That arms him with all the information he needs to head back over to Tallahassee and fight the good fight, which he is where he is because he does fight the good fight, and we're grateful for his leadership. You have a list of leaders out here in the panhandle that I could get into. Representative Petronas, Representative Coley. I mean, they're amazing out here, and I would say that the panhandle of Florida, in my experience out here, they love to pride themselves on their own unique culture, but I would say that without their investment in the process, the rest of the population in Florida is not sitting idly by. So okay. I would say that we're looking at good involvement from the panhandle, but more is always better.
Thank you, Brad. And
welcome.
I know our members work with the Florida Chamber a lot.
Yeah, they do.
We keep them informed as well.
Yeah, and we're grateful for it. So thank you for our great partnership. I can't speak highly enough about the partnership between your organization and ours.
Yes, thank you. And thank you, Brad. I want to acknowledge our guest today, Mr. Brad Swanson, Vice President of Corporate and Strategic
Partnerships. That's right.
With the Florida Chamber of Commerce. I also want to thank Cox Communications for providing us this venue so that we can get this information out to you. And we hope you'll join us next month and for the Vision of Growth.
Can I add one more thing?
Yes, please do.
I would say that as we transition into the summer economy, that everybody should come down and participate in your beaches and your community here. It is a fantastic community. My family loves coming here. But I would also say, as we're enjoying our summertime, let's not forget that although it's hot and it's time for everyone to think about 4th of July, et cetera, it is time to get engaged in the process. So I would say just reach out to your local elected officials here and see how you can help. I'm sure they will have no problem putting you all to work for anyone that would be interested, any businesses that would be interested in getting engaged.
Thank you.
You're welcome.